Hello guys, this is Indian Medico and in this video we are going to see a review of Otorhinolaryngology or ENT. In this video we'll take a disorder and first we'll see all the high yield points, that is we'll see a summary of the disorder, following which we'll see a clinical image of the disorder for us to understand better. First let us see disorders of ear. The first condition we are going to discuss is otitis externa. Otitis externa is also known as swimmer's ear. It is generalized infection involving the external ear canal and often the tympanic membrane. The cause of otitis externa is prolonged water exposure, as in cases of swimming, and damaged squamous epithelium of the ear canal like hearing aid use. The most common pathogen implicated in otitis externa is Pseudomonas. Other pathogens include Proteus, Staphylococcus, E. coli, fungi like Aspergillus and Candida, virus like Herpes zoster and Herpes simplex. This picture shows a case of otitis externa. As you can see, there is infection of external ear canal. Let us see about the clinical features of otitis externa. There will be otalgia or earache. There will be swelling of external ear canal. There will be erythema. There will be pain on manipulation of the auricle. There will be debris in canal and otorrhea or ear discharge. How do you treat a case of otitis externa? We have to keep the ear dry. For mild infections, we can do cleaning and dilute acetic acid drops can be given to the patient. We have to do complete removal of all debris and topical antibiotics can be given with or without hydrocortisone. How do you differentiate a case of otitis externa and otitis media? In otitis externa, there will be severe pain upon manipulation of the auricle. This is a key differentiating feature between the two. Now let us see about malignant otitis externa. It is also known as necrotizing otitis externa. It is fulminant bacterial otitis externa. It is not a malignant cancer, so the name is a misnomer. Usually, it affects elderly patient with poorly controlled diabetes. The causative organism is Pseudomonas aeruginosa. The classical feature is a nub of granulation tissue on the floor of the external ear canal at the bony cartilaginous junction, as you can see in this picture. There is granulation tissue on the floor of the external ear canal. Now let us see about the signs and symptoms. There will be severe ear pain, there will be excessive purulent discharge, and there will be exposed bone. Now let us see about the diagnosis of malignant otitis externa. CT scan will show erosion of bone and inflammation. Technetium 99 scan will show temporal bone inflammatory process. Gallium tagged white blood cell scan is done to follow and document resolution of malignant otitis externa. What are the complications of malignant otitis externa? Invasion of surrounding structures can lead to cellulitis, osteomyelitis of temporal bone and mastitis. There can be facial nerve palsy, meningitis and brain abscess as a complication of malignant otitis externa if it is not treated properly. Now let us see about the treatment of malignant otitis externa. Control of diabetes, meticulous local care with extensive debridement, hospitalization and IV antibiotics. We have to give anti-pseudomonas antibiotics, that is an aminoglycoside plus a penicillin. Now let us see about the tumors of external ear. The most common type of tumor of external ear is squamous cell carcinoma. Occasionally, there can be basal cell carcinoma or melanoma. These tumors usually arise from auricle. Occasionally, they can arise from external ear canal. As you can see in this picture, this is a squamous cell carcinoma of the ear canal. The risk factors for squamous cell carcinoma or other tumors of the external ear is excessive sun exposure. How do you treat a case of external ear cancer? For cancers of the auricle, we can do wedge excision. When there is extension to canal, we have to do excision of external ear canal or partial temporal bone excision. When there is middle ear involvement, we have to do en bloc temporal bone dissection and lymph node dissection. Now let us see about tympanic membrane perforation. The etiology can be due to trauma, either direct or indirect. It usually occurs secondary to slap to the side of the head due to compression injury or explosions. It can also occur secondary to middle ear infection. What are the symptoms of tympanic membrane perforation? There will be pain, bleeding from the ear, conductive hearing loss, and tinnitus. Now let us see about the signs of tympanic membrane perforation. There will be clot in the meatus and visible tear in the tympanic membrane, as you can see in this picture. How do you treat a case of tympanic membrane perforation? We have to keep the ear dry. We have to use topical antibiotics if there is infection or contamination. 90% of cases of tympanic membrane perforation heal spontaneously. However, larger perforations require surgery. The various surgical options include fat plug, temporal aspasia, and tragal cartilage tympanoplasty. Now let us see about cholesteatoma. It is epidermal inclusion cyst of middle ear or mastoid containing descamated keratin debris, as you can see in this picture. It can be acquired or congenital. Now let us see about the causes of cholesteatoma. Primary acquired cause is negative middle ear pressure from eustachian tube dysfunction. Secondary acquired cause is direct growth of epithelium through a tympanic membrane perforation. Cholesteatoma is usually associated with chronic middle ear infection. There is history of chronic ear infection with chronic malodorous discharge in cases of cholesteatoma. How does a cholesteatoma appear? It appears as grayish white, shiny keratinous mass behind or involving the tympanic membrane. It is classically described as a pearly lesion. How do you treat a case of cholesteatoma? Surgery, which is aimed at eradication of disease and reconstruction of the ocular chain, is the treatment of choice. The various surgical options include tympanoplasty or mastoidectomy. Now let us see about bullous meningitis. It is vesicular infection of the tympanic membrane and adjacent deep canal. This picture shows bullous meningitis. What are the causative agents of bullous meningitis? The exact causative agent is not yet known. However, viral etiology is suspected because it is frequently associated with viral upper respiratory tract infection. In some instances, mycoplasma pneumonia has been cultured in cases of bullous meningitis. Symptoms include acute severe ear pain, low grade fever, and bloody drainage. On otoscopic examination, there is a large reddish blebs on tympanic membrane, wall of the meatus, or both. Hearing is affected rarely in case of bullous meningitis. Occasionally, there will be reversible sensory neural hearing loss. How do you treat a case of bullous meningitis? Oral antibiotics can be given. Erythromycin is the treatment of choice if mycoplasma is suspected. Topical analgesics may be used. The symptoms usually resolve in 36 hours. Now let us see about acute suppurative otitis media, which is abbreviated as ASOM. It is bacterial infection of middle ear, often following a viral upper respiratory tract infection. It may be associated with a middle ear effusion. The cause of acute suppurative otitis media is dysfunction of eustachian tube that allows bacterial entry from nasopharynx. It is often associated with an occluded eustachian tube. This is uncertain whether it is a cause or a result of the infection. The predisposing factors for acute suppurative otitis media are young age, male gender, bottle feeding, crowded living conditions like a daycare, cleft palate, Down syndrome, and cystic fibrosis. Now let us see about the pathogens implicated in acute suppurative otitis media. The most common pathogen is Streptococcus pneumoniae. It is seen in 33% of cases of acute suppurative otitis media. Other pathogens include Haemophilus influenzae, Moraxella catarrhalis, Staphylococcus, beta hemolytic streptococci, Pseudomonas aeruginosa, viral causes. Sometimes nothing can be cultured. In infants less than 6 months, Staphylococcus aureus, E. coli, and Klebsiella are the major pathogens. Now let us see about symptoms of acute suppurative otitis media. Otalgia or earache, fever, decreased hearing. The infant usually pulls on the ear and it will be irritable. In 25% of cases of acute suppurative otitis media, the patient will be asymptomatic. Now let us see about the signs of acute suppurative otitis media. Early cases will have redness of the tympanic membrane. In late cases, the tympanic membrane will bulge with loss of normal landmarks, as you can see in this picture. There is tympanic membrane bulging. Finally, there will be impaired tympanic membrane mobility on pneumatic otoscopy. If pain disappears instantly, we have to suspect tympanic membrane perforation. What are the complications of acute suppurative otitis media? Tympanic membrane perforation, acute mastitis, meningitis, brain abscess, extradural abscess, and labyrinthitis are the various complications of acute suppurative otitis media. If recurrent or chronic, otitis media may have adverse effects on speech and cognitive development of children as a result of decreased hearing. Now let us see about the treatment of acute suppurative otitis media. 10-day course of antibiotics. Amoxicillin is the first line agent. If there is penicillin allergy, we have to use trimethoprim and sulfamethoxazole or erythromycin. Now let us see about the usual course of the disease. The symptoms usually resolve in 24 to 36 hours with treatment. Now let us see about the indications for meningotomy and pneumatic equalization tube placement in cases of acute suppurative otitis media. When there is persistent middle ear effusion over 3 months, when the patient is debilitated or immunocompromised, and when there is greater than 3 episodes over 6 months, especially if both the ears are involved. In all these cases, we have to place a PE tube, which is basically a tube placed through tympanic membrane. Now, let us see about Bessel's abscess. It is abscess behind the superior attachment of sternocleidomastoid muscle resulting from extension of mastoid infection. This picture shows a case of Bessel's abscess. Now, let us see about chronic otitis media. The causes of chronic otitis media is mixed. That is, it can be due to a mixed infection of Staphylococcus aureus and Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Now, let us hear about the signs and symptoms of chronic otitis media. There will be otorrhea or ear discharge and hearing loss. This picture shows the tympanic membrane appearance in chronic otitis media. Unilateral serous otitis media is often associated with nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Now let us see about acoustic neuroma. It is also known as vestibular schwannoma. It is the most common posterior fossa tumor. It usually occurs at cerebellopontine angle. This is the vestibulocochlear nerve and this is the tumor. This picture shows radiological appearance of acoustic neuroma. Now let us see about otosclerosis. It is a genetic disease characterized by abnormal spongy and sclerotic bone formation in the temporal bone around the foot plate of the stapes, thus preventing its normal movement. It is an autosomal dominant disease with incomplete 1/3 penetrance. The symptoms of otosclerosis are painless progressive hearing loss. It can be unilateral or bilateral, and tinnitus. The onset of the disease is between 2nd to 4th decade. Now let us see about the diagnosis of otosclerosis. There will be normal tympanic membrane with conductive hearing loss and no middle ear effusion. There may be mixed hearing loss or even sensory neural hearing loss if bone of cochlea is affected. Schwartz sign is a classical sign seen in otosclerosis. It is erythema around the stapes from hypervascularity of newborn formation. This picture shows Schwartz sign in a case of otosclerosis. Now let us see about the treatment of otosclerosis. Surgical options include stapedectomy with placement of prosthesis, hearing aids or observation. Medical management is with sodium fluoride. It can be given when there is sensory neural component of hearing loss or for preoperative stabilization. Now let us see about facial nerve paralysis. The causes of facial nerve paralysis are Bell's palsy, trauma, cholesteatoma, tumors like carcinoma and glomus jugulare, herpes zoster inflammation of geniculate ganglia. This is known as Ramsey-Hunt syndrome. Peripheral lesions like parotid gland tumors can also lead to facial nerve palsy. Lyme's disease, which is caused by Borrelia burgdorferi, can also lead to facial nerve palsy. In fact, the most common cause of bilateral facial nerve palsy is Lyme disease. Now let us see about Bell's palsy in detail. It is sudden onset, unilateral facial weakness or paralysis in absence of CNS, ear, or cerebellopontane angle diseases. That is, there is no identifiable cause for the facial nerve palsy in case of Bell's palsy. Now let us see about the clinical course of Bell's palsy. It is acute in onset with greatest muscle weakness reached within 3 weeks. Bell's palsy is the most common cause of unilateral facial weakness. Now let us see about the pathogenesis of Bell's palsy. The exact pathogenesis is not yet known. It is thought to be of viral etiology because herpes virus is implicated in Bell's palsy. Other factors include ischemic and immunologic factors. A common preceding event is upper respiratory tract infection. Now let us see about the clinical features of Bell's palsy with the help of this picture. There will be flattening of the wrinkled lines on the forehead. That is, there will be flattening of forehead wrinkles. There will be widening of the opening between the eyelids. There will be flattening of the fold on the lip, that is nasolabial fold. And there will be drooping of the corner of the mouth on the affected side. Now let us see about the signs and symptoms in detail. The pathology is related to swelling of the facial nerve, leading to the various clinical features of Bell's palsy. There will be total facial paralysis, altered lacrimation, increased tearing on the affected side, change in taste if region above caudal tympani is affected, dry mouth and hyperacusis can be seen. How do you treat a case of Bell's palsy? Usually no treatment is required as most cases resolve spontaneously in 1 month. We have to protect the eyes with drops and tapes. Steroids and acyclovir can be given. Surgical decompression of the 7th cranial nerve is indicated if paralysis progresses or tests indicate deterioration. Now let us see about the prognosis of Bell's palsy. 90% of patients recover completely. The prognosis depends on whether the affected muscles are completely paralyzed. If not, prognosis is greater than 95% complete recovery. Now let us see about Meniere's disease. It is a disorder of the membranous labyrinth causing fluctuating sensorineural hearing loss, episodic vertigo, nystagmus, tinnitus and oral fullness along with nausea and vomiting. The classical triad of Meniere's disease is hearing loss, tinnitus and vertigo. Now let us see about the medical treatment of Meniere's disease. Salt restriction, diuretics like thiazides, anti-nausea agents, antihistamines and occasionally diazepam is used for Meniere's disease. 80% of patients respond to medical treatment. Now let us see about indications for surgery in case of Meniere's disease. Those who fail medical treatment or those who have incapacitating vertigo can undergo surgical treatment for Meniere's disease. It is 60 to 80% effective in treating incapacitating vertigo. The various surgical options include labyrinthectomy, vestibular neurectomy, endolymphatic sac surgery and transtympanic gentamicin injections for a chemical labyrinthectomy. This picture explains the pathogenesis in Meniere's disease. As you can see, there is backed up fluid which leads to swelling and pressure. There will be swelling which distorts balance information leading to vertigo, and there will be swelling which distorts sound information leading to hearing loss and tinnitus. Now let us see a classical case of Meniere's disease. A 28-year-old man with intermittent vertigo, intermittent hearing loss and tinnitus and a subjective feeling of having ear swelling. This is how a case of Meniere's disease presents to you. Now let us see about glomus tumors. These are benign, slow growing tumors arising in glomus bodies found in the adventitial layer of blood vessels. They are associated with cranial nerves 9 and 10 in the middle ear. The usual location of glomus tumors is middle ear, jugular bulb, in the course of cranial nerve 9 to 12. It is the most common benign tumor of temporal bone. This picture shows a glomus tumor. It is also known as glomus tympanicum. How do you treat a case of glomus tumor? We have to do surgical resection. We can give radiation therapy for poor operative candidates or for recurrences. Now let us see about disorders of nose and paranasal sinuses. First, let us discuss epistaxis. Epistaxis is basically bleeding from nose. The risk factors for epistaxis are trauma, anticoagulants, nose picking, sinus infection, allergic or atrophic rhinitis, blood dyscrasias, tumor, environmental extremes like hot, dry climates and winters. The cause of epistaxis is rupture of superficial mucosal blood vessels. The blood vessels involved are Kieselbach's plexus if anterior epistaxis and sphenopalatine artery in case of posterior epistaxis. The most common type of epistaxis is anterior epistaxis. 90% of cases of epistaxis are anterior epistaxis and the usual cause is trauma. This picture shows Kieselbach's plexus. These blood vessels are ruptured in case of anterior epistaxis. This is the sphenopalatine artery. This is ruptured in case of posterior epistaxis. Though anterior epistaxis is the most common type of epistaxis, the more serious type of epistaxis is posterior epistaxis. It is usually seen in elderly patients and it is usually associated with a systemic disorder like hypertension, tumor and arteriosclerosis. Now let us see about the treatment of epistaxis. Direct pressure is the treatment of choice. If direct pressure fails, we have to proceed to nasal packing. The last resort in management is ligation or embolization of the sphenopalatine artery in case of posterior epistaxis or ethmoidal artery in case of anterior epistaxis. Now let us see about acute sinusitis. It is seen in previously healthy patient with unrelenting progression of a viral URI or allergic rhinitis beyond the normal 5 to 7 day course. This is a classical case of acute sinusitis. That is, there will be progression of a viral URI beyond 5 to 7 days. Now let us see about the pathophysiology of acute sinusitis. It is thought to be secondary to decreased ciliary action of the sinus mucosa and edema causing obstruction of the sinus ostia, lowering intra-sinus oxygen tension and predisposing patients to bacterial infection. Now let us see about the causative organisms of acute sinusitis. Cultures are negative in 50% of cases, so it is thought to be of viral etiology. Bacterial causes include pneumococcus, staphylococcus aureus, group A streptococci and Haemophilus influenzae. Now let us see about the symptoms of acute sinusitis. There will be periorbital pressure or pain. There will be nasal obstruction, nasal or postnasal mucopurulent discharge, fatigue, fever and headache. Now let us see about the signs of acute sinusitis. There will be tenderness over affected sinuses and pus in the nasal cavity. There will also be signs of obstruction which are thought to be the cause of acute sinusitis. We have to look for septal deviation, spur and tight osteometal complex which can lead to obstruction which will in turn lead to sinusitis. Now let us see the clinical features of sinusitis with the help of this diagram. First let us discuss sinus anatomy. The various sinuses include frontal sinus, ethmoidals and maxillary sinus. These sinuses can get infected. This is the nasal cavity. Now let us see about the signs and symptoms. These are the areas of localized pain and there will be thick nasal discharge from both nostrils that may be worse on one side. There will also be severe headache. There may be redness, tenderness or swelling in and around the eyebrows and eye. Now let us see about the treatment of acute sinusitis. 14 day course of antibiotics should be given. The antibiotics commonly used are penicillin G, amoxicillin or amoxicillin clavulanic acid. Topical and systemic decongestants can be used. Saline nasal irrigation can be done. Now let us see about fungal sinusitis. It is caused by mucor in immunosuppressed patients. Treatment is IV antifungals like amphotericin or caspofungin and surgical debridement of all necrotic tissue. Now let us see about chronic sinusitis. It is infection of nasal sinus lasting greater than 4 weeks or pattern of recurrent acute sinusitis punctuated by brief asymptomatic periods. Now let us see about the pathology of chronic sinusitis. There will be permanent mucosal changes secondary to inadequately treated acute sinusitis. There will be mucosal fibrosis, polypoid growth, inadequate ciliary action or hyperostosis, which is increased bone density on CT scan. The causative organisms of chronic sinusitis include anaerobes like bacteroids, velonella or rhinobacterium. Other causative organisms include Haemophilus influenzae, Streptococcus viridans, Staphylococcus aureus and Staphylococcus epidermidis. The symptoms of chronic sinusitis are chronic nasal obstruction, postnasal drip, mucopurulent rhinorrhea, low-grade facial and periorbital pressure and pain. This picture shows the anatomy. Once again, this is the maxillary sinus, this is the frontal sinus, and these are the ethmoidal air cells. Chronic sinusitis will lead to thickened sinus lining, leading to various clinical features discussed in the previous slide. Now let us see about the treatment of chronic sinusitis. Medical management with decongestants, mucolytics, topical steroids and antibiotics. If medical management fails, we have to proceed to endoscopic or external surgical intervention. The surgery of choice is FES. It is functional endoscopic sinus surgery. Now let us see about the complications of chronic sinusitis. It can lead to orbital cellulitis if there is ethmoid sinusitis. Other complications include meningitis, epidural or brain abscess in case of frontal sinusitis. If ethmoid or sphenoid sinus is involved, it can lead to cavernous sinus thrombosis. It can lead to pars perfi tumor, which is basically a osteomyelitis, if frontal sinus is involved. Now let us see about cancer of nasal cavity and paranasal sinus. It usually involves the maxillary sinus. Maxillary sinus is the location of cancer of paranasal sinuses and nasal cavity in 66% of the cases. Other sites include nasal cavity, ethmoid sinus. It is very rare in frontal and sphenoid sinuses. The most common type is squamous cell carcinoma. It is seen in 80% of cases. Other types include adenocarcinoma, sarcoma and melanoma. Esthesioneuroblastoma is a rare tumor that arises from olfactory epithelium. The site is high in the nose, that is cribriform plate, and it is locally invasive. Now this picture shows maxillary sinus carcinoma. This picture shows esthesioneuroblastoma. Now let us see about the signs and symptoms of cancer of nasal cavity and paranasal sinuses. Early clinical features include nasal obstruction, blood-tinged mucus and epistaxis. Late features include localized pain, cranial nerve deficits, facial and palate asymmetry and loose teeth. Now let us see about the diagnosis of cancer of nasal cavity. We can do CT scan to identify extent of the disease and local invasion. MRI can be done to evaluate soft tissue disease. Treatment is with surgery with or without radiotherapy. The 5-year survival for T1 or T2 lesion is around 70%. Now let us see about juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. It is the most commonly encountered vascular mass in nasal cavity. It is locally aggressive but non-metastasizing. It is usually seen in adolescent boys. The presentation is nasal obstruction, recurrent massive epistaxis, and there can be anosmia. The site of origin is the roof of the nasal cavity at the superior margin of sphenopalatine foramen. As you can see in this picture, it arises from roof of the nasal cavity. It can transform into fibrosarcoma, but it is very rare. Now let us see about the diagnosis of juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma. It is diagnosed using carotid arteriography and CT scan. Biopsy is contraindicated in cases of juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma because there is a risk of uncontrollable hemorrhage. How do you treat a case of juvenile nasopharyngeal angiofibroma? Surgery via lateral rhinotomy or sublabial maxillotomy is the treatment of choice. We have to remove the tumor. Bleeding should be controlled by internal mammillary artery ligation or preoperative embolization. Preoperative irradiation can be used to shrink the tumor. Now let us see about diseases of oral cavity and pharynx. First, let us discuss about pharyngotonsillitis. It is acute or chronic infection of the nasopharynx or oropharynx and Waldeyer's ring of lymphoid tissue. Now let us see about the components of Waldeyer's ring: palatine tonsil, lingual tonsil, pharyngeal tonsils and the adenoids are the components of Waldeyer's ring. Now let us see about acute pharyngotonsillitis. These are usually caused by viruses like adenovirus, enterovirus, Coxsackie virus, Epstein-Barr virus. Bacterial causes include group A beta hemolytic streptococci. Chronic tonsillitis is a mixed infection caused by streptococci, staphylococci and Moraxella catarrhalis. Now let us see about the symptoms of pharyngotonsillitis. Acute cases will present with sore throat, fever, local lymphadenopathy, chills, headache and malaise. Chronic cases will present with noisy mouth breathing, speech and swallowing difficulties, apnea and halitosis. This picture shows a case of pharyngitis. You can see red and inflamed pharynx. This picture shows a case of tonsillitis. You can see the inflamed tonsils. Now let us see about the signs of pharyngotonsillitis. Viral pharyngotonsillitis will present with injected tonsils and pharyngeal mucosa. The exudate is less common. In case of bacterial cause, there will be swollen inflamed tonsils with white yellow exudate in crypts and on surface. There will also be cervical lymphadenopathy. Now let us see about the diagnosis of pharyngotonsillitis. Complete blood count should be done. Throat culture and monospot test are also helpful in the diagnosis of pharyngotonsillitis. Let us see about the complications of pharyngotonsillitis. If it is not treated properly, it can lead to peritonsillar abscess or quincy. It can also lead to retropharyngeal abscess causing airway compromise. Other complications include rheumatic fever and post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis with beta-hemolytic streptococci. How do you treat a case of pharyngotonsillitis? Viral causes can be treated by symptomatic treatment with acetaminophen, warm saline goggles and anesthetic throat spray. For bacterial causes, we have to give a 10-day course of penicillin. We can give erythromycin if the patient is penicillin allergic. Now let us see about tonsillectomy. The indications for tonsillectomy are sleep apnea or carpal nail secondary to airway obstruction. We can do tonsillectomy when there is suspicion of malignancy, hypertrophy causing malocclusion, peritonsillar abscess, recurrent acute or chronic tonsillitis. Complications of tonsillectomy are acute or delayed hemorrhage. Now let us see about peritonsillar abscess. It is a complication of tonsillitis. Etiology is inadequately treated recurrent, acute or chronic tonsillitis. It is a mixed infection. The pathogens are both aerobes and anaerobes. The pathogens may be penicillin resistant also. It usually begins at the superior pole of the tonsil. The symptoms include severe throat pain, drooling dysphagia, odynophagia, trismus, cervical lymphadenopathy, fever, chills, malaise, and a classical hot potato voice. This picture shows peritonsillar abscess. Now let us see about the clinical findings. There will be a bulging erythematous edematous tonsillar pillar, as you can see in this picture. There will be swelling of uvula and displacement of uvula to contralateral side, as you can see in this picture. The uvula is displaced to the other side. Now let us see about treatment of peritonsillar abscess. IV antibiotics and surgical evacuation by incision and drainage. Tonsillectomy can be done after resolution of inflammatory changes. Now let us see a classical case of peritonsillar abscess. 16-year-old girl with severe sore throat, lateral uvula displacement, bulging tonsillar pillar, and she is positive for Streptococcus pyogenes. This is how a classical case of peritonsillar abscess presents to you. Now let us see about Ludwig's angina. It is infection and inflammation of the floor of the mouth. It is usually present in the sublingual and submandibular region. This picture shows Ludwig's angina in sublingual region, and this picture shows Ludwig's angina in submandibular region. The source of infection in case of Ludwig's angina is dental infection. How do you treat a case of Ludwig's angina? Antibiotics, emergency airway, incision and drainage are the treatment options for Ludwig's angina. Now let us see about oral cavity cancer. The most common type of oral cavity cancer is squamous cell carcinoma. It is seen in more than 90% of cases of oral cavity cancer. The most common sites are lip, tongue, floor of mouth, gingiva, cheek and palate. This picture shows a cancer of the lateral part of tongue. Oral cavity cancer is linked to smoking, alcohol, smokeless tobacco products. It is important to remember that when a person uses both alcohol and tobacco, it greatly increases the risk of oral cavity cancer. HPV or human papillomavirus is also a risk factor for oral cavity cancer. The incidence of HPV is on the rise. In case of oral cavity cancer, there will be regional metastasis in 30% of cases. There will be a second primary in 25% of cases. Nodal metastasis in case of oral cavity cancer depends on size of tumor. It is seen in 10 to 60% of cases. It usually spreads to jugular and jugulodigastic nodes and submandibular nodes. Distant metastasis is infrequent in case of oral cavity cancer. Now let us see about diagnosis of oral cavity cancer. We have to take a complete history and do a proper physical examination. Dental assessment should be done. Dental panoramic radiograph or bone scan should be done if mandible is thought to be involved. CT scan or MRI should be done to detect the extent of tumor and nodal disease. Fine needle aspiration can be done. It should often be ultrasound guided. Treatment is radiation or surgery for small lesions. Localized lesions can be treated surgically. For larger lesions, we have to give combination therapy, mandibulectomy and neck dissection. Now let us see about the prognosis of oral cavity cancer. The most common cause of death in successfully treated head and neck cancer is development of a second primary, which occurs in 25% of cases. HPV positive tumors have a better prognosis. In case of CA tongue, the survival is 20 to 70%. In case of CA floor of mouth, the survival is 30 to 80%. Now let us see about salivary gland tumors. The most common sites are parotid gland. 80% of cases of salivary gland tumors are parotid gland tumors. 15% are submandibular gland tumors and 5% are minor salivary gland tumors. Though minor salivary gland tumors are less common, but whenever they occur, they are malignant. That is, 80% of cases of minor salivary gland tumors are malignant. In case of parotid gland tumors, though they are more common, but they are benign. 80% of cases of parotid gland tumors are benign. It is important to remember that the smaller the gland, the greater the likelihood of malignancy. Benign salivary gland tumors are mobile, non-tender, there is no lymph node involvement or facial weakness. Malignant salivary gland tumors are painful. They are a fixed mass with evidence of local metastasis and facial paresis. This is actually a picture of tonsillitis. I wanted to put a picture of salivary gland tumors. I somehow missed it. Really sorry. This picture shows parotid gland tumor. Now let us see about the diagnosis of salivary gland tumors. Fine needle aspiration can be done. It is important to remember that excisional biopsy of a parotid mass is contraindicated. How do you treat a case of salivary gland tumors? We have to do adequate surgical dissection. Superficial parotidectomy can be done for benign lesions of superficial lobe of parotid gland. We have to Do facial nerve sparing surgery if possible. Neck dissection should be done for node positive tumors. Post-operative radiation therapy should be done if there is high-grade cancer, recurrent cancer, residual disease or invasion of adjacent structures. It should also be done for T3 or T4 parotid tumors. Now let us see about pleomorphic adenoma. It is the most common benign salivary tumor. It is a benign mixed tumor. It usually affects parotid gland. It is well delineated and slow growing. Now let us see about Wharton's tumor. It is the second most common benign salivary gland tumor. 95% of cases of Wharton's tumor are found in parotid. 3% of cases of Wharton's tumor are bilateral. Wharton's tumor is a slow growing cystic mass usually located in the tail of the superficial portion of the parotid gland. It rarely becomes malignant. The most common malignant salivary tumor is mucoepidermoid carcinoma. Parotid mucoepidermoid carcinoma is more common than submandibular gland. The second most common malignant salivary tumor is adenoid cystic carcinoma. Adenoid cystic carcinoma usually occurs in the submandibular and minor salivary glands. Now some other important points regarding salivary glands are: the most common cause of parotid swelling is mumps. Heerfordt's syndrome is sarcoidosis with parotid enlargement, facial nerve palsy and uveitis. Salivary gland stones are usually found in cases of gout. Stone formation is most common in submandibular salivary gland. Mikulicz syndrome is any cause of bilateral enlargement of the parotid, lacrimal and submandibular glands. Now let us see about croup or laryngotracheobronchitis. It is viral infection of larynx and trachea. It usually affects children between 6 months to 3 years of age. Boys are more affected than girls. Now let us see about the cause of croup or laryngotracheobronchitis. Parainfluenza virus is implicated in croup. It is seasonal. It is usually preceded by upper respiratory tract infection. The classic symptom in croup is barking cough, which is seal-like and non-productive. Other symptoms include respiratory distress and low-grade fever. Now let us see about the signs of croup. There will be tachypnea, inspiratory retractions, prolonged inspiration, inspiratory stridor, and expiratory ronchi or wheeze. Any of these signs can be present in case of croup. Now let us see about the differential diagnosis of croup. We have to rule out epiglottitis, bacterial tracheitis, foreign body, diphtheria, retropharyngeal abscess, peritonsillar abscess and asthma. How do you diagnose a case of croup? AP neck x-ray shows classic steeple sign indicating subglottic narrowing. This is the steeple sign seen in case of laryngotracheobronchitis. This indicates subglottic narrowing. Arterial blood gas analysis can be done. It will reveal hypoxemia and hypercapnia. Now let us see about the treatment of croup. We have to keep the child calm. This is because agitation will worsen the obstruction. Cool mist, steroids, aerosolized racemic epinephrine are the treatment of choice for reducing edema and airway obstruction. Intubation should be done if airway obstruction is severe or if child becomes exhausted. Croup results in 3 to 4 days with proper treatment. Complication of croup is secondary bacterial infection with streptococcus and staphylococcus. Now let us see about epiglottitis. It is severe, rapidly progressive infection of epiglottis. The causative agent is Haemophilus influenzae type B. It usually affects children between 2 to 5 years of age. Now let us see about the signs and symptoms of epiglottitis. it is sudden in onset, there will be high fever, hot potato voice will be seen in epiglottitis, there will be dysphagia which will progress to drooling, cough will be absent in epiglottitis. The patient prefers to sit upright and lean forward. The patient appears toxic and there will be stridor. Diagnosis of epiglottitis is clinical. Direct observation of epiglottis is contraindicated because it may worsen obstruction by causing laryngospasm. So we need not visualize the epiglottis. Treatment is immediate airway support. We have to do intubation or tracheostomy. Medical treatment is with steroids and IV antibiotics against Haemophilus influenzae. Now let us see a classic case of epiglottitis. A 48-year-old man presents with a 3-day history of otorhinolaryngology, that is painful swallowing, fever with temperatures of up to 40 degrees Celsius and progressive shortness of breath. Physical examination showed inspiratory stridor. He was sitting in the tripod position and was using accessory muscles for respiration. A lateral radiograph of the neck showed the thumb sign. This is a classical sign seen in epiglottitis, which is suggestive of enlarged epiglottis. Immediate tracheostomy was performed while the patient was awake, and after tracheostomy, laryngoscopy was done, which revealed erythematous, edematous and exudative inflammation of epiglottis. This picture shows erythema, edema and exudative inflammation of epiglottis with complete obstruction of airway. Intraoperative cultures from the epiglottis grew Streptococcus pyogenes. After 5 days of treatment with IV antibiotic agents targeting Streptococcus pyogenes, the tracheostomy tube was removed and the patient was discharged with a 14-day course of oral amoxicillin clavulanate. This is the repeat laryngoscopy after 14 days, which shows resolution of epiglottitis. Now let us see about malignant lesions of larynx. They account for 2% of all malignancies. They are more common in males. They are more common in glottis. 66% of cases of CA larynx occur in glottic region. 33% occur in supraglottic region. The worst prognosis is for subglottic tumors. They are very infrequent and they account for less than 1% of cases of CA larynx. Risk factors for CA larynx are tobacco and alcohol. 90% of cases of CA larynx are squamous cell carcinoma. Now let us see about the symptoms of CA larynx: hoarseness, throat pain, dysphagia, otorhinolaryngology, neck mass and referred throat pain, that is ear pain, are the various symptoms of CA larynx. It is important to remember that throat pain is usually referred to the ear. Now let us see about supraglottic lesions. CA supraglottis appears in laryngeal surface of epiglottis, as you can see in this picture. It usually affects the pre-epiglottic space. They remain confined to supraglottic region or may extend to valicula or base of tongue. There will be nodal metastasis. Now let us see about the treatment of CA supraglottis. In early stage tumors, we can do radiotherapy. For late stage tumors, we have to do laryngectomy. Now let us see about CA glottis. They occur in the anterior part of true cords. This picture shows various parts of the larynx. This is the vocal cords, that is the glottic part, and there is CA which affects the cords. The part above it is called supraglottis and the part below it is called subglottis. Subglottic cancers are very rare, but they are very bad, that is they have a very bad prognosis. Supraglottic tumors are common. Now coming back to glottic lesions. Glottic lesions may invade thyroid cartilage, cross midline to invade contralateral clot or invade paraglottic space. Nodal metastasis is rare in case of glottic lesions, unlike supraglottic lesions. The treatment is same. For early stage, we give radiotherapy, and for late stage, we do laryngectomy. Now let us see about the functions of larynx, airway protection, airway or respiration, and phonation. So in diseases of larynx, any of these can be affected. What is cricothyroidectomy? Cricothyroidectomy is emergent surgical airway by incising the cricothyroid membrane. Now let us discuss about neck mass. The most common causes of neck mass in infants are congenital causes like branchial cleft cysts, thyrogrossal duct cysts. In adolescents, the cause is inflammatory, most commonly cervical adenitis, or they can be congenital. In case of adults, the most common cause of neck mass is malignancy. The most common malignancy is squamous. In case of malignancy causing neck mass, the neck mass will be painless and immobile. It is important to remember that 80% of neck masses are benign in children, whereas 80% of neck masses are malignant in adults above 40 years of age. Now let us see about the cardinal symptoms of neck masses. There will be dysphagia or difficulty in swallowing, odynophagia or painful swallowing, hoarseness, stridor, which signifies upper airway obstruction, globus, which is a feeling of having a lump in the throat. There can be speech disorders, and there will be referred ear pain via cranial nerves 5, 9 or 10. Now let us see about the workup of a case of neck mass. We have to do full head and neck examination. Indirect laryngoscopy can be done. CT scan and MRI can be done. Fine needle aspiration cytology should be done for tissue diagnosis. It is important to remember that biopsy is contraindicated because it will adversely affect survival if malignant. Now let us see about the differential diagnosis of neck mass. Inflammatory causes include cervical lymphadenitis, cat scratch disease, infectious mononucleosis, and infection in neck spaces. If there is neck abscess with sulfur granules, it indicates actinomyces infection. As discussed earlier, congenital causes include thyroglossal duct cyst, which is midline and it elevates with tongue protrusion, branchial cleft cyst, which present as lateral neck mass, dermoid cyst, which present in the midline in submental region. Other causes include hemangioma and cystic hygroma. Neck masses can be neoplastic masses, that is, they can be primary or metastatic masses. Whenever there is a node positive squamous cell carcinoma and no primary site, we have to do triple endoscopy, that is laryngoscopy, esophagoscopy and bronchoscopy. We also should do biopsies of likely sites and PET scan. How do you treat a case of neck mass? Surgical excision is the treatment of choice for congenital or neoplastic causes. When you confirm cancer, we have to do selective or modified neck dissection, postoperative chemotherapy or radiotherapy. Now let us discuss various neck dissections. First, let us discuss radical neck dissection. This involves removal of nodes from clavicle to mandible. We also remove sternocleidomastoid muscle, submandibular gland, tail of parotid, internal jugular vein, digastric muscles, stylohyoid and homohyoid muscles, fascia within the anterior and posterior triangles, spinal accessory nerve, and cervical plexus sensory nerves. In modified neck dissection, again we remove lymph nodes in levels 1 to 5 with preservation of one of the following three structures. We preserve either spinal accessory nerve or internal jugular vein or sternocleidomastoid in modified neck dissection. There are a few contraindications for modified neck dissection. The contraindications include presence of distant metastasis and fixation of vital structures like carotid artery. Now let us see about selective NEET dissection. In this, one or more of the lymph node groups in levels 1 to 5 are preserved based on the location of primary tumor. The decision to perform a selective NEET dissection is based on the location of the primary tumor and its likelihood to metastasize to a specific site. Now some important points regarding NEET malignancy are: the most common malignant NEET mass in children, adolescents and young adults is lymphoma. The most common primary malignant solid tumor of head and neck in children is rhabdomyosarcoma. Now let us discuss about facial fractures. First let us discuss about mandible fractures. The symptoms include gross disfigurement, pain, malocclusion and drooling. The signs of mandible fractures are trismus, fragment mobility, lacerations of gingiva and hematoma in floor of mouth. Now let us see about complications of mandible fractures: malunion, non-union, osteomyelitis and temporomandibular joint ankylosis are the various complications of mandible fractures. This picture shows a mandible fracture. Now let us see about the treatment of mandible fracture. We have to do open or closed reduction. Maxillomandibular fixation can be done with wire jaw shut. Now let us see about midface fractures. We have to do careful physical examination and order a CT scan for midface fractures. They are classified by Lefort classification. Lefort type 1 is transverse maxillary fracture above the dental apices, which also traverses the pterygoid plate. In this case, the palate is mobile but nasal complex is stable. This line is Lefort type 1 fracture. You can see there is a transverse maxillary fracture which is above the dental apices and it traverses the pterygoid plate. Lefort type 2 is fracture through the frontal process of the maxilla through the orbital floor and pterygoid plate. This line is Lefort type 2. As you can see, the fracture traverses through the frontal process of the maxilla and the orbital floor and pterygoid plate. In this case, the entire midface is mobile. Now let us see about Lefort type 3. There is complete craniofacial separation. This line indicates Lefort type 3 fracture. In this case, there is complete craniofacial separation. It differs from type 2 in that it extends through the nasofrontal suture and frontozygomatic sutures. Let us see about tripod fracture. It is fracture of the zygomatic complex. It involves four fractures: frontozygomatic suture fracture, fracture of inferior orbital rim, zygomaticomaxillary suture and zygomaticotemporal suture. Now let us see about blowout fractures. Blowout fracture is orbital fracture with blowout of supporting bony structural support of orbital floor. The patient will have enophthalmos, which is sunken in eyeball. Blowout fracture is usually associated with entrapment. It is orbital fracture with entrapment of periorbital tissues within the fracture opening. It may involve entrapment of extraocular muscles. Loss of extraocular muscle mobility will be seen. Example, lateral tracking and diplopia. This picture shows fracture of the right inferior orbital wall with herniation of the orbital fat into the superior aspect of maxillary sinus and entrapment of inferior rectus muscle. So this is a blowout fracture with entrapment. What is the step off fracture? Fracture of the orbit with palpable step off of bony orbital rim is present in this case. Some important points regarding facial fractures are: mandible forms an anatomic ring, so greater than 95% of mandible fractures have more than one fracture site. The best x-ray study for mandible fractures is panoramic dental x-ray. In case of nasal fracture, if there is septal hematoma, it must be drained immediately because there is a chance of pressure-induced septal necrosis. Now, just a quick revision of microbiology in ENT. Croup is most commonly caused by parainfluenza virus. Otitis externa is most commonly caused by pseudomonas. Epiglottitis is usually caused by Haemophilus influenzae. Malignant otitis externa is usually caused by Pseudomonas aeruginosa. Parotitis is usually caused by Staphylococcus. Acute suppurative otitis media is usually caused by Streptococcus pneumoniae. This video was just a review of ENT. I have made separate videos on important topics. Please check out the ENT playlist for them. If you have any suggestions, please let me know in the comment section. If you like my videos, kindly subscribe. Your subscription will encourage me to make more videos. Thank you.